Okay, good. So today we're going to go over osmosis a little bit more in depth. So you guys, we kind of talked about that already, so this should be a little bit of a review. But what do you know about osmosis so far?
Yeah, Cassie. It's the diffusion of water.
Good, so it has diffusion in it. So let's create a definition for osmosis. And you don't write this part down, but so far we know it talks about diffusion, right? Diffusion of what?
Water.
Of water, right? What else do we know about osmosis?
It's passive.
It's passive transport, which means it doesn't require what?
Energy.
Good. And then there should be one more thing maybe that we know. No, you know, that's good. We'll keep it there. So we have these two parts. So then let's write that into like a sentence form. So if I ask you, what is osmosis, you'll be able to tell me. So let's say that osmosis is a form of passive transport for water molecules. Just put your pencils down and so I can move on. Okay, good. So if I asked you then, what is osmosis, you would say?
A form of passive transport for water molecules.
Good, okay. Now, we've talked that there's pros to diffusion and passive transport. There's lots of good things, there's also bad. So let's make a T-chart. Then we'll do the pros and cons. So what's one of the pros to passive transport? Yeah, is that?
Yeah.
Doesn't require energy, right? So that's good. No energy required. So if there's no energy required, does that mean that it's easy to get what the cell needs or wants, or is it hard?
Easy.
Easy, right? Like, you don't have to do any energy, it just comes to you, it's real simple. So, cell can get what it wants. Cell is able to get its wants. Good, so there's definitely some pros. It's super easy. They can just take it in, like when we breathe in oxygen. All my cells, the blood carries the oxygen right to them. They don't have to worry or really think about it. What's our con, though, to this whole process? Say it louder. You can't control, right? So if I go and I stand behind a bus and its engine is running, is that going to be good? No, right? Those fumes, as I breathe in, I'm taking in those fumes, those particles in the air. It's also going into my bloodstream, which is also going into cells, which make me sick. So you have little to no control. What enters the cell. So somebody on this side, tell me what's the pro to passive transport?
No.
How about Naomi, do you want us to go? No energy required, super easy. Then this side, what's the con to having passive transport take place?
Little to no control over what enters the cell.
Good. So this is really important for our cells, and we're going to talk about the osmolarity or the osmotic environment, so if you guys want to move over here. On the bottom of your paper, what I want you to do is you're going to create this table where you can draw a line, and you're going to split it into three sections on the bottom. the egg lab with you guys, we were constantly changing what? Were we constantly changing the egg or the environment?
Environment.
Yeah, we were constantly changing the environment. And so when we talk about osmosis, we're really talking about the environment. So label this the osmotic. The osmotic environment. Good. So there's three types of, or three conditions for our osmotic environment. The first one, do you guys know what the first one is?
Hypertonic.
Isotonic. And then the second one, anyone?
Hypotonic.
Let's do, hypotonic.
And hypertonic.
And then the last one?
Hypertonic.
So we're talking about the osmotic environment of a cell, its surrounding environment. It has these three options. And just after, on your own guess, which one do you think the cell would like or wants to be at?
Isotonic,
right? So that's, okay, let's go into that. So when we break these words apart, tonic equals solute. You can write that on the side. So for the first one, iso, when we break that apart, iso equals same. Same or equal. So then, Carlos, if I say something is isotonic using this breakdown, what am I really saying?
Same solute.
Has the same solutes on the inside and the outside. Good. So the easiest way for me to think about this is we'll just draw a picture. So draw your environment. And your cell. So I'll let you guys give me a number. What do you want to say for the water concentration inside?
70.
70? Okay. So there's 70 water, which then means how many solutes will there be inside?
30.
How many?
30.
30, good. So if this is isotonic, iso meaning same, then how much water am I gonna have on the outside?
70.
How much water?
70.
How much water?
70.
70, right? Iso means same. So on the outside then, I'm gonna have 70. It might be around 69, 70. It's gonna bounce a little bit, but generally it's gonna be 70 and 70 water, which means that our solutes are also gonna be 30. And then I can draw my arrows like you guys did on your worksheets where it's gonna go in and out of the cell. Just like that activity where you guys are moving across the room, going back and forth. It's not that half of them are just hanging out inside and half of them are hanging out on the outside. It's that they're just moving in and out at the same or regular pace with generally the same concentrations on the inside and the outside. So you guys don't need to write this down, but I'm going to show you a short little clip of red blood cells. As soon as it pops up. Did everyone get this part over here? Okay, so has anyone here ever seen like what a blood cell looks like? Like, you know, generally what shape it is? Circle, right? kind of looks like a donut, like if you want to draw. So when we have isotonic, our cells are trying to always get to this point because it's nice, everything's balanced, that's what the cell's like, it keeps happy. So when we have an isotonic osmotic environment, our cell is going to be pretty much just like a circle. And it kind of has like this like inner indent, almost kind of like a donut, but it's filled in, it doesn't have a hole in the middle of it. And we've been kind of talking, when you breathe in, what are you breathing in?
ATP.
Oxygen, right? And then the oxygen goes in your blood and it carries it to all the cells in your body, which is important, right? So the shape of the cell is very important as to how much oxygen it's able to hold and carry. And so this nice big round shape here in an isotonic environment means it can carry oxygen quickly and efficiently to your cells. So what this video is up here, and Lorraine, you guys can just leave it on that side of the room. I'm going to show you some of the red blood cells in an isotonic solution. So when you guys saw it up there, they're just kind of like round little shapes all kind of clustered about, so that was your isotonic. Before we show you the hypotonic one over here, hypo. And the way that we remember this is, what animal does hypo sound like?
Hippo.
Hippos are the small and skinny, or
the
big fat animals, right? Thousands of pounds. So for your hypotonic environment, so draw your environment again, your cell. And when we talk about osmosis, what are we diffusing? Are we diffusing molecules or water?
Water.
Water. So without even knowing the numbers, which way is the water going to go in this one? Is it going to go in or out of the cell?
In.
It's going to go in or out. Remember when we put this egg, it was in syrup, then we put it in water. What happened to the egg? Did it get bigger or smaller?
Bigger.
It got bigger, right? So where did the water go?
In.
Inside the cell, right? That's why it's bigger. It got fatter. It was skinny. It's kind of, it looked like a raisin before, but now it's fatter because the water's gone in. So without even knowing the numbers, you should know that in a hypotonic environment, water can go in. So yeah, this is good because it helps to replenish the cell with hydration, with water. But it can actually get to the point where the cell explodes or bursts. So these two, hypo and hypertonic, are important to a blood cell's overall health and stability. But having too much water can actually be a bad thing for the cell. It will explode. And so for our shape here, like if a normal red blood cell is a circle, this one's going to be kind of poofed out maybe a little bit because it's going to have so much excess water, it's going to look really big and fat. Just like that?
Yes.
So you kind of see, like, they're super round, but some have a little, like, bulges out to them. They're not perfectly round circles. They have excess water in them. All right. And then we have the last one, hypertonic. And hyper equals high. So who here has a younger sibling or is around little kids? If a kid's being hyper, what does that mean? They're like running around going like crazy, bouncing off the walls. If you're constantly running around crazy, bouncing off the walls, is your body mass going to be big and large or kind of skinny and small? Skinny and small, right? Like hyper kids, really crazy kids that are running around constantly, they're not overweight usually for the most part. Like they're going to be super tiny. Yeah.
Do you mind if I give you
what?
The hyper.
Sure.
Okay, so
heard of it, yeah.
Well, I have it, and it's, I originally was, hyper, I had hyperactive thyroid, and so I was super skinny, I was, hyper all the time, but now, I got my thyroid taken out, and so now I'm hypo.
Oh.
And so now I'm, the opposite, so lazy.
You gotta be careful how much pizza you take in, right, or you're gonna start to...
Basically,
yeah. No, my mom had her thyroid taken out too. So yeah, our body tries very hard to control our environments very hard, and if our thyroids, which we'll learn more about that later actually in this class, that can be part of it. So hyper means high. So without even knowing the numbers, which way is my water mostly gonna go?
Out.
It's gonna go up. You don't have to know the numbers. You know that's gonna go up because that cell, if you looked at the red blood cell, it's gonna be all kind of shriveled and ugly. Is it gonna be able to hold lots of oxygen and carry it throughout the blood that way?
No.
No, definitely not. Here, the cells, there's some of the round ones that are some of the white blood cells, but like these little guys here, they're all shriveled up. They're not round and smooth like the red blood cells are supposed to be. So those are blood cells. These ones are Alloydia leaves, which is like a plant. And you can see some of the plant's cells. So this is your isotonic one. So this is what they're supposed to look like, right? You guys know these parts? So you can see the kind of the squareness of each of these plant cells. What are all these little green guys?
Oh, it's
chloroplasts, right? Chloroplasts all throughout that. So it's this nice, normal, square shape. It looks just like the picture you have drawn on your maps. So if we go to hypo. Big difference, right? Big, round, fat. And then the last one should be hyper. So what are they going to look like?
Shriveled.
We all think shriveled really small. Remember before you had these big, beautiful round circles, now if you look at them, they're all tightly shriveled up, weird little shapes. Alright, so we have our three kinds. What's the first one?
Isotonic.
Isotonic, right? And so where is the water moving in this one?
In and out.
I mean in and out, right? Both. And then when we go to hypo,
it's
moving in, right? Cell's gonna expand. So we said this was kind of like the hippo. Or the other way you can think about it too is if you say hypo, what's an O? Big round shape O like that. More biology gang signs. And then this one was the hyper, like the hyper kid. Does everybody have this part? Can you erase it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Pretty easy. Yes, no?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not hard. It's just you already have all the information. Now we just put the name tags on it.
Last part. So we talked the other day, I think, in this class about if you go to the hospital and let's say you've been dehydrated, they're gonna give you an IV, like in your arm.
Oh,
they're trying.
Wait, I'm gonna add a story real quick. Sorry.
Yeah. Go ahead.
So that student teacher that I had, because he was a medic, so he's crazy. Like he kept a whole bunch of medical supplies, and also his long story short, he has access to medical supplies, so he always has like shots and syringes and IV bags at his house and all kinds of deals and stuff like that. So when they go hiking, he takes IV bags or whatever. He takes he doesn't drink throughout the whole thing, and then he just gives himself an IV at the very end. Why does he give himself an IV at the end? He's trying to hydrate. I go, isn't it easier just to drink water? He goes, yeah, but it's not as much fun. Anyway, so when you get an IV, sometimes you do it just because you're dehydrated, and that's the only way. Has anybody been really dehydrated and you tried to drink a lot of water? Who's been really dehydrated before? This happened to me several times, and then you get really thirsty, right? So then you start drinking a whole bunch, and then what do? Then you puke. You start puking because your body can't assimilate that much. That's why sometimes it'll give you an IV, because what it takes for you to drink the water and actually get it to assimilate your body, you have to pass through, instead of going straight to your bloodstream and getting it straight to all the tissue, they have to go through your stomach first, then your bloodstream, and that's an extra step that can make you sick. So they'll just give you an IV sometimes. So, sorry.
No, you're good. Yeah, so if we wanted, so here's our, this is our cell, right? We have our little nucleus, and then this is the bloodstream. If we wanted to replenish our cells and hydrate them again, which solution, which osmotic environment would we want to put our cells in? Iso, hypo, or hyper? Don't say it aloud, just tell your partner and talk to you guys and decide which one would you want to give. You want to hydrate your cells because you've been dehydrated, which one are you going to give?
Hypo.
And they get punched.
Is that
probably not. That's just, I think those are speakers.
All right, everyone's good? So how many of you would want to put it in a hypotonic solution? Raise your hands for hypo, meaning that you're trying to put water into the cell. How many people say hyper? How many people say isotonic? Couple in the back. Okay, so let's say the majority of you guys said hypotonic. So this is our cell, this is the environment, just like here. Our bloodstream is what's carrying it to our cell. So let's say that inside our bodies, we should be about 96% water. Or here, sorry, hold on, just have that. We're dehydrated. It should be about 96, we'll say. This is what is considered normal. 96 water, about 4% solutes. That's considered normal. So if we're dehydrated, say we put about 90 for the water, so that would make our solutes a little bit higher. If I put it into a hypotonic solution, since that's what you guys picked, where is the water going to go? You go in the water. So I'm putting the water in, it's going to come down, and I'm going to try to hydrate, the water's going to go in the cell. So let's say it's 100. So if I have more water, so much water on the outside, and I'm trying to pump it, what's going to happen? Where's the water going to go?
Inside.
It's going to go inside, but what can also happen if we have too much water?
It'll pop.
It's going to pop, it's going to rupture, it's not going to be able to do its job. So we don't want to put in a hypotonic solution because we could actually do too much of a good thing, and this number is going to go way high over what it's supposed to be, and our cells are not going to be able to, they're going to rupture, they're going to burst. None of you guys said hypertonic, which makes sense, right? If I'm dehydrated already and I put something in a solution with a lot of solutes and I'm pulling out more water, that's not going to help me get hydrated. So for those of you guys who said isotonic, that is the correct answer. I'll let you guys, maybe you can tell me why. So let's say for isotonic, which would be about here, so if I put in 96 water, where is the water still going to go? Still going to go in, right? Because there's still more out here compared to inside. But is this going to ever go over the point of where I don't want to be, the normal? No, right? So when you get an IV, it has a saline solution, it's like an isotonic environment. Because they're not trying to just flood your cells with water, that's not good for them either. It could burst. If we put an isotonic one then, it's going to raise the cell, but can this one ever get above 96? No, it can't. And so you're able to replenish the cell without overdoing it. It might take a little bit longer, but you don't have the problems of the hypotonic. So good. So if you guys, you can turn that off. Just hit the button again. So you guys did a little bit